please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
You're watching CNBC TV 18 and this is Reporter's Diary. Now, from Karnataka to Goa to Bihar to Manipur, the opposition is up in arms. This after what can only be described as a dramatic development in the Indian politics since 9:30 p.m. last night when the governor invited B.S. Yeddyurappa to form the government in Karnataka. Yeddyurappa took oath as the Chief Minister of Karnataka early this morning, even as opposition leaders protested outside the Bangalore Assembly. All this after the Supreme Court opened its gates at 1:45 a.m. in the morning to hear a petition challenging the governor's decision. The court ruled at 5:30 a.m. this morning that it will not stop Yeddyurappa swearing in, but has scheduled the next hearing in the case tomorrow. So with Yeddyurappa invited to form the government as the leader of the single largest party, Congress MLAs in Goa are seeing an opening. 15 months after elections in the state, Congress is now staking claim to form the government as it is the single largest party. The BJP under Manohar Parikar formed the government with support from others to even though the Congress was the single largest party with 17 seats in Goa. In Bihar, the Janata Dal United fought the elections with Lalu Prasad's RJD in 2015, but JDU dumped RJD last year and allied with the BJP. Now, RJD is claiming its stake to form the government in Bihar as the single largest party. Take a look at some of the reactions that have been pouring in.
Aaj is desh mein constitution par zabardast aakraman ho raha hai. आपने कर्नाटक में देखा एमएलए एक तरफ खड़े हैं और गवर्नर दूसरी तरफ खड़े हैं और आप जानते हो कोशिश क्या है जेडीएस के नेता ने कहा है कि 100 करोड़ रुपए उनके एमएलए को ऑफर किया गया है
पीपल शुड नो अबाउट द एटीट्यूड ऑफ दिस बीजेपी सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट हेडेड बाय नरेंद्र मोदी अकॉर्डिंग टू वेर इज the strength in BJP to prove their majority on the floor. How this governor behaved, he has not properly taken any decision according to the law and according to his power. He misused his office.
We go to the people. Okay. And we may, today we are making protest here.
Okay.
And we will go to the people and we will tell the people how the BJP people is supporting constitution and going against the provisions of the constitution. And they have no belief in democracy. They have no belief in parliamentary democracy. See, all these things will go take people.
Earlier he had sacrificed, Waju Bhai Wala had sacrificed his seat in the Gujarat Vidhan Sabha in favor of Shri Narendra Modi. Yesterday evening and then today morning, Waju Bhai Wala sacrificed the constitution and democracy for Modi ji. It was not a swearing in of B.S. Yeddyurappa ji today, but it was an ugly picture of swallowing in ceremony of democratic principles, judicial verdicts, and established precedents.
Now, the decision by Karnataka's governor Waju Bhai Wala to invite the BJP despite the lack of majority obviously did not go unchallenged. The Congress and the JDS moved the Supreme Court late last night seeking a stay on the swearing-in ceremony. What ensued was a four-hour-long midnight thriller. Ashpreet Sethi, who spent the night tracking that development, joins us now to take us through what unfolded.
Well, high voltage drama pre-midnight, post-midnight, 10:30 p.m. is when the whole saga started after the governor's letter was disclosed as to how he's invited BJP to form the government as is the single largest party with the votes in Karnataka. However, Congress, JDS filed a joint plea. They approached the registrar. 10:30 p.m. is when all the drama started. 11 o'clock across the registrar saw the file, checked for defects, took it to Chief Justice of India's residence post 12, after which which the master of the roster decided that a three-judge bench led by Justice A.K. Sikri will be hearing the matter, because remember, there has been a lot of criticism against Justice Deepak Mishra as the Chief Justice and how he distributes the matters for hearing, especially from Congress. Now, of course, the ball shifts to the Supreme Court. There, 1:45 a.m., the matter hearing starts in court number 6, where the matter hearing goes on till about 5:30 in the morning, over 3.5 hours, where Mukul Rohatgi, who's representing BJP, argued that it wasn't a hearing which merit midnight, post-midnight hearing at odd hours. Yakub Memon was the earlier one which was heard post odd hours because it was a matter of life and death. However, Congress, on the other hand, said that BJP is trying to be arbitrary and unconstitutional as far as going ahead and forming a party without majority seats is concerned. But the Supreme Court said they will not be staying the oath-taking ceremony. They said go ahead with it. However, whichever developments will happen in Karnataka will be subject to the final outcome of the Supreme Court verdict. The 10:30 a.m. hearing is tomorrow. In the meantime, Congress has filed an urgent plea saying that no MLA should be brought in by the BJP right ahead of the floor test. Otherwise, it will be constitutional from the Anglo-Indian community.
All right, Ashpri, thank you very much for joining in. So that important hearing at the Supreme Court is tomorrow. But meanwhile, the controversy over the terms of reference for the 15th Finance Commission refuses to die down. Today, ministers from several non-NDA rule states met in Delhi to take their concerns to President Ramnath Kovind. Tibzi Jaipuria caught up with the Finance Minister of West Bengal ahead of the State FM's meeting with the President. And here's an excerpt of that conversation.
I have state finance ministers with me who are going to soon submit a memorandum to the president on the amendments that they are seeking for the terms of reference regarding 15th Finance Commission. Sir, what are the amendments that you are seeking, and what do you think that a president should do with an immediate effect?
I think what is important is we have gathered together. Also, the Chief Minister of Puducherry would be joining us at the president's house. There are three issues which we are deeply concerned about. First is infringement on the provisions of the Constitution vis-a-vis the terms of reference of the 15th Finance Commission. It really impinges and infringes the terms of the Constitution. And that we have given specific changes that we have requested to the Honorable President of India. The second is disrupting well-settled fiscal and federal arrangements between the states and the central government. Very disruptive, which will hurt the whole process. Third is the technical mistakes that have been made that we have discussed among ourselves and found very, very unusual to have such technical mistakes. Overall, I think our general sense is that the federal polity of this country will be undermined by these terms of reference being implemented.
Straight on to the action on Dalal Street now. A last hour dip saw benchmarks end at the low point of the day. The mid-caps, however, bucked the trend. The Nifty breached the 10,700 mark, ending about 0.5% in the red. The Sensex also shed 240 points. Banks, however, managed to hold on to the 26,000 mark, ending 100 points in the red. Mid-caps outperformed today with gains of 0.2%. From equities to commodities then, crude oil prices continued to surge, with the Brent inching closer to near a four-year high of $80 a barrel. While the surge in prices augurs well for oil-producing countries, it is a big worry for oil-importing nations like India. Government officials tell CNBC TV 18 that there will be implications on subsidies, revenue and also excise duty on fuel. Any surge in oil prices has major implications on India's fiscal math, so we learned that the government may have to reassess the pricing formula for LPG and kerosene subsidies. With crude prices scaling up, the government's budget estimates may overshoot a whopping 10 to 20,000 crore rupees, and sources say that the government will first consider its revenue position before taking any decision on cutting excise on petrol and diesel. Now to the latest in the insolvency space then, there's a new twist in the Bhushan Steel case. Neeraj Singhal, who holds 20% stake in Bhushan Steel, has challenged the NCLT order, giving nod to Tata Steel's resolution plan for Bhushan Steel. NCLAT has agreed to hear Neeraj Singhal's plea on the 21st of May. Meanwhile, Kritika Saxena caught up with TV Narendran, the CEO and MD of Tata Steel, and began by asking him about the plans he has for Bhushan Steel after receiving NCLT's nod to acquire the company. He said that Tata Steel will make additional investments for the plant expansion over the next 3 years.
It will continue to be a listed subsidiary of Bhamnipal Steel, which is a SPV that we've set up. Hmm. Bhamnipal Steel will be 100% owned subsidiary of Tata Steel.
Okay.
And Bhushan Steel, Bhamnipal Steel will invest in Bhushan Steel. Hmm. So eventually we will take a call. In a year or two, we will see how things go.
So no immediate plans to look at a delisting or a merger, at least for the next 1 or 2 years?
Absolutely.
5.1 to 5.5 million tons is the overall capacity that it has. It's functioning on 3.1 roughly?
About 3 to 3.5.
So what is the increase that you can look at, and by how much can you scale this in the near term?
So we can easily take it to 4, 4.5 with the existing upstream facilities that they have.
In 1 year's time?
Yeah, in 1 year's time. That's our ambition. The sooner we get there, the better. Hmm. So that is one part of it. Then we need to debottleneck and see what we can do to get the upstream facilities to 5, 5.5. Hmm. We have an option over the next 3 years as Kalinganagar ramps up, that we will have more slabs in Kalinganagar than we can use in Kalinganagar.
Okay.
So that allows us an opportunity to send slabs to Bhushan to make better use of their rolling facilities.
Hmm.
So between Kalinganagar and Bhushan, we believe we can go to 5, 5.5 million tons with increasing the existing upstream in Bhushan and supplementing with some of the slabs that we can get out of Kalinganagar.
Hmm.
Beyond 5 million, we'll call for investments. But there is a potential in that site to take it to 8 million or even higher.
Yeah.
So, but that will come after maybe 3 years or so, once we exploit the facilities that there are today.
The big story from the banking sector then, the government officials tell CNBC TV 18 that public sector banks that are under RBI's prompt corrective action will need to be recapitalized immediately. Remember, Piyush Goyal, who has been given the charge of finance ministry for some time, met the heads of 11 public sector banks under prompt corrective action today. Meanwhile, speaking to CNBC TV 18 earlier, in his first official address after taking charge, Piyush Goyal said that RBI is diligently supervising the situation to ensure the orderly growth of the banking industry. Listen in.
The Reserve Bank of India, since 2015, after the Modi government came in, is really ensuring proper banking supervision, is taking action against defaulters, something which I believe under previous governments was not given the kind of serious attention that it deserved. The indiscriminate lending of the past has caused this distress that the banking sector is facing. And I'm very confident that with the diligent efforts of all my colleague bankers, all the lakhs of employees of the public sector banks, and all the stakeholders of the banking system working in close cooperation and under the guidance of our regulator, Reserve Bank of India, we will ensure a very orderly growth of the industry and the highest levels of probity and accountability that is expected of the public sector banks.
News and updates will continue on the other side.